conditions, homeopathy was only not enough. We do need to integrate other forms of supportive or supplementary and complementary aids like yoga, meditation, balanced nutrition, exercise, and other systems of holistic health. Also, in today's scientific world, understanding the underlying pathophysiology of any disease is extremely essential, which is often ignored or unknown. So taking this initiative forward, we organized our first webinar on COVID for kids today. This was in consideration of the third wave of COVID, which is being predicted to be affecting kids largely. And we have today with us Dr. Dushyant Punwani. Many of us know him from our college days, but for those who don't, Dr. Punwani completed his MBBS from CHGS Medical College in 1975, and thereafter his MD from King Edward Memorial, better known as the KEM Hospital, Mumbai. He is a gold medalist of the Mumbai University and has a vast experience of treating all kinds of complicated pediatric illnesses for the last 43 years. Dr. Punwani was associated with the CMP Medical College as a teacher and also headed the Department of Pediatrics at the Mumbai Devi Hospital. His open-minded approach and his support and belief in the homeopathic system made us learn about and treat many complicated cases with homeopathy under his guidance. I have personally had the privilege to work under him and know him to be extremely dedicated, prompt, punctual, highly meticulous, and a perfectionist in treating his little patients. Though he appears to be very strict, he has a very compassionate and considerate side to his personality, which has helped his patients too. So now, taking no more time of yours, I will ask sir to take over and start today's webinar. I again kindly request all of you to please keep your audios and videos muted. Your cooperation in this regard will help us conducting the webinar in a smooth manner. Also, you can put all your questions in the chat box provided. All your queries will be answered at the end of the session. So I hand over the mic to sir. Let's start the journey. Happy learning to all of you. Sir, you can take over.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Mugda, for inviting me and for this very, very generous introduction. Now, this idea was suggested, as Dr. Mugda said, because of this anticipated third wave. But just 48 hours ago, data was released showing that children are not really more affected than adults. Under 10, in the first wave, it was 3%, and in the second wave, it was 3.5%. 10 to 20, under 10 was about 8% and 8.5%. So there's no greater involvement of children as the waves progress. The virus does not know that whether it's affecting a child or an adult. It's just that because of the variants, more cases will be detected. And so since children form a particular proportion, there will be more children affected. So we're talking about what you as primary physician should do or should not do when you deal with a case of suspected COVID. Right. Now SARS-CoV-2 refers to severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2. That's why it's called SARS-CoV-2. This was the name first announced in February 20, though the cases had started in December 19. The disease is called coronavirus infectious disease 19. Now this coronavirus is called illnesses ranging from the common cold to severe serious conditions like MERS or SARS, severe acute respiratory syndrome. They are transmitted between animals and people. The original SARS was transmitted by a cat called the civet cat to human beings. And the origins of this current virus are investigated. You probably know there's a lot of theory going on that China has deliberately manipulated this virus and released it as a weapon or it was a leak from a Chinese laboratory and one Chinese researcher was jailed for releasing that. So we really don't know, but theories born and millions have been affected by this virus. However, in children, the majority of cases are asymptomatic or mild. About 5% are moderate and less than 1% are severe. So we should concentrate on the asymptomatic or mild, because the moderate and severe are hospital cases not handled by us, neither by me nor by you. Now, what do you mean by asymptomatic? It's a child who's detected because of screening. There's a case in the family, you do a family screening and you find that the child is positive. He has no fever, no cough, no symptoms at all, no sore throat, no body ache, no malaise, no diarrhea, no nausea, no loss of smell or taste, which is very rare in children anyway, no dyspnea, no shortness of breath, very important, respiratory rate is normal, and the oxygen saturation is above 95% at room air. So the role of the primary doctor is it COVID or is it not COVID the illness? Is testing required? If it is COVID, is it mild, moderate, or severe? Now, what do you mean by is it COVID? What are the symptoms which may point to COVID? The symptoms are non-specific and resemble any other viral illness. So the child may have headache, myalgia, muscle pain, body ache, fatigue, tiredness, no energy to play, lethargy, sore throat, dry cough, and uncommonly altered bowel habits, vomiting. In children, refusal of feeds, lethargy, refusal to play, these are all pointers to a serious illness. So how do you differentiate this from other viral illnesses? As you can see, in COVID, fever is common. It's not common in the common viral cold. Maybe there in influenza and never there in allergies. Dry cough is common. Shortness of breath is common, which is not there in the viral cold, what we call, or in flu, and it's common in allergies, because asthma and shortness of breath are common features of allergic reactions. Headaches are common. Aches and pains, as we told you, myalgia. Sore throat is very common as a presenting symptom. Fatigue is very, very common. Diarrhea is not common. Runny nose does not occur. So that's a common pointer. But in the common cold, you have a runny nose, you have severe rhinitis. Whereas this is not common in COVID-19, and there is no sneezing in COVID. So this is just to help you differentiate between COVID-19, the common cold, influenza, and allergies. So then you have come to the second question, do we need to test the child? When do you test the child? When he has symptoms. The majority, as I told you, are asymptomatic, so you do not test. But if the child has severe sore throat, fever lasting for more than 3 days, breathlessness, fatigue, loss of appetite, refusal of feeds, loss of energy, then you do a test. Either you do a rapid antigen test, which is cheap and gives you a result in a few hours, or you do a RT-PCR, which takes a minimum of 12 to 24 hours and is expensive. If the rapid antigen test is positive, then there are no false positives. If then it's COVID, you have to classify it into mild, moderate, or severe. If it is negative, there are a lot of, there were 40% false negatives in rapid antigen tests, and the symptoms still suggest COVID, then you have to do an RT-PCR. If the RT-PCR is positive, then again you have to classify COVID as mild or severe. If it is negative, then it's almost certain that it is not COVID, but you still have to monitor the child, because you can get false negative RT-PCR if the sample is not collected properly. If the technician just puts it at the tip of the nose and doesn't go deep inside or in the oropharynx, or if the sample is not kept properly, or if you have fake agencies, as you can read what's happened in the Kumbh Mela, you have 1 lakh fake RT-PCR negative tests. So you still have to monitor the child if you have any suspicion of COVID. So how do you classify mild, moderate, and severe? Mild is one who has got a mild sore throat, no dyspnea, low temperature, 95 to 100. And if any of those things change, it becomes moderate or severe. Mild case will be monitored at home. moderate and severe cases require admission. So if the temperature persists for more than 3 days, doesn't respond to treatment, most viruses in 48 hours, the fever will reduce or disappear and the child will come out with a rash or diarrhea. If the oxygen saturation is decreasing, if there is tachypnea, the urine output goes down, very important indicator of a mild disease becoming moderate. The child's fluid down, and if the child becomes less alert, if it becomes drowsy, not responding to visual stimuli, showing total apathy, just wants to lie down, then you better get suspicious that this disease is progressing. So you have to monitor these things. So this is what we said, these are differences between mild, moderate, and severe. As you see, fever goes up, increasing from mild to moderate to severe. Cough worsens, body ache worsens, malaise worsens. Shortness of breath becomes very prominent in moderate and severe disease, and the respiratory rate increases, the oxygen saturation decreases. So these are the things you have to monitor. Now, how do you classify tachypnea? Depends on the age. Children below the age of 2 years have a rapid respiratory rate, so you can cut off only when it crosses 60. Under 1 year, it's 50 per minute. 1 to 5 years is 40, and above 5 years is less than 30 per minute. These are the normal. If the child breathes faster than this, then it call it tachypnea. Now, this is what you do, monitor at home. You give this to the child. It can be in the local language. They have to monitor the temperature, the pulse rate, and the respiratory rate, the oxygen saturation. Monitor the pulse oximeter. In addition, the parents have to note the urine output, and if he develops other symptoms like lassitude, loss of appetite, malaise, drowsiness, rarely diarrhea, vomiting. And this has to be done 3 times a day. At the end of the day, every day, the parent or the caretaker has to report to the treating primary physician. The physician who has put the child on home monitoring has to insist that the patient either calls or WhatsApps or messages or emails this report every evening. And if you find anything which is abnormal here, then you pay attention. Either you call the child for an examination or you send him to a COVID care center, but do not ignore anything that is abnormal. So this has to be done for 5 days, and this sort of a chart is to be kept at home. What are the rules? What do you do at home? Child stays in a well-ventilated room alone, in a separate toilet. The first thing when you get a case is you ask them, do you have a separate toilet for home isolation? Because fomites can be transmitted by the taps and other commode seats, other articles in the toilet. Well ventilated, because we do not recommend the use of air conditioning, which is recycling the same air. So it has to have good ventilation with good fan. No antibiotics, not only in the mild, but even in the moderate, we'll tell you when they are to be used. Symptomatic treatment, if at all. A very important normal diet. You can eat a kumto kanji, you're going to be very unhappy. So you say yes to everything, including pizza, burger, cold drinks, whatever. Not at cold, but room temperature. Extra fluids, because if you don't give enough fluids, the child will get dehydrated, he get tachypneic, and his condition will worsen. You give extra salt, because that helps with the drowsiness, and the sugar helps with the energy. So this is very, very important. You insist that the parents give a fully normal diet, and keep a record of the fluids. It has to be 100 to 150 ml per hour. Then again, you know, the severity of the disease is much more in